Thank you, Congressman, for joining us this morning. We were just, he has a very wide swath of activities. Part of them is terrorism and counterterrorism justice, but I said you've got to put your cancer hat on today. And he's going to do that. And you've been one of the leaders in the House that really picked up the torch from one of your previous colleagues on kind of raising many of these questions. So let me just start out, because I think you've got some news on the Survivorship Treatment Access and Research Act. What's your news?
Well, the STAR Act is coming to the floor this afternoon, and we fully expect it to pass the Congress.
Today. I think that's...
I've been working on this for quite, as many of y'all know, the advocates, I've been working on it for quite some time, but this will really help us in terms of really sharing threat information is what I do in the counterterrorism. This would be applicable to, you know, the physicians that treat childhood cancer.
So that is a tweetable moment for those of you who didn't get it. Hashtag STAR Act. Why does it matter?
Well, because right now, survivorship, we always think that when the victim, the child conquers cancer and survives, that it's over. And in fact, there are many issues that come into their lives down the road, dealing with the chemotherapy, the radiation, the treatment. And so this provides a data registry, so physicians have access, the parents have access, and the victims have access to all this data information so we can better treat survivorship, but also be better at research and access.
Why was it, I know it had passed the House, and I know you had 346 some co-sponsors, but it still seemed like it was an uphill climb. Yeah. So without giving us a kind of how a bill becomes a law, song, why is it so hard when, I mean, clearly it's going to pass today, it had enormous support, but what is mucked up that this isn't easy?
And this is completely bipartisan, not Republican, Democrat, and it shouldn't be. That's why I formed the caucus, to provide a voice for the children.
Tell them about the caucus.
And caucus we formed a decade ago to provide a voice for children that really didn't have a voice in Washington. All the other special interest groups have high-paid lobbyists, and yet our most valuable asset, our children, had really no, other than the advocates themselves, really didn't have a whole lot of a voice. So we tried to galvanize members of Congress to focus on the issue, which I was quite frankly surprised that there wasn't more interest on the part of the members. Deborah Price had led the effort many years ago. Her daughter, Carolyn Walker Price, passed away, and a bill was passed over a decade ago. But to answer your question about the bill, we passed it before in the House. We just had to wait on the Senate to get it passed. They work a little slower than the House does, so we had to wait for them to get this done. And then there's a little bit of horse trading between Energy and Commerce, House and Senate, to get other bills done, and they were holding up the STAR Act as sort of a way to get other bills passed as well, knowing that this was a bill that everybody could rally behind. And I'm really proud to say this is a fourth bill, childhood cancer bill, that we passed since we formed the caucus, and it's been one of the most gratifying experiences of my career.
Why don't you mention, because you did the Creating Hope Act, right? Which, and that was one we mentioned Nancy Goodman earlier, that would be very involved with you. What's it like to deal with Nancy Goodman?
is she here?
I don't know. She's lurking. So. Oh my God, there she is. Nancy, I want you to know, I only said good things earlier. But I was telling you that Nancy was one of the people I most admire in this town, because she put her mind to something, got people together, and began working tenaciously to pass it. So I actually am not asking that facetiously. What is it like to work with Nancy Goodman? How do you inspire more Nancy Goodmans out there?
Well, we need more, and there are some in this room that I see. She's very determined.
You're all important. I wish I knew all of you, but I do know.
Very determined, very hardworking, very smart. She is sort of my ideas person that I go to for these bills. I go to the advocates in the various groups for their ideas. And what I want bills that are realistic, that can pass, and not put something out there that the advocates get their hopes up about and then get crushed, because they've had enough bad experiences in their lifetime. And so, Nancy and I developed this great relationship. She's a hardcore Democrat. I'm obviously a Republican, but we didn't care
How
about
much
that.
Are you hardcore Republican?
I'm a rational Republican. Yeah. If there are any of us left. And, So Nancy and I formed this great partnership. We worked together on this Creating Hope Act idea, which is the priority review voucher. So that means if you're developing a childhood cancer drug that we hadn't had since the 1980s, you would get a voucher for another drug that you're developing, which would then go to the front of the line. These vouchers are worth somewhere between $100 to $300 million. So what we did was we created a market incentive where we had a market failure, which is why we weren't seeing childhood cancer drugs being developed. Interestingly, the first childhood cancer drug that came out of this program was to treat neuroblastoma. And the clinical trial was in my hometown of Austin at Dell Children's Hospital, little Rex Ryan, this blonde-haired, blue-eyed kid. You know, and for me, to Steve, to walk in, and I've done a lot in Congress, but for me to see a kid like this one, who is just adorable, running around, knowing that as a direct result of a bill I got passed, that he is alive today, I don't think there's anything more profound, you know, than that.
You know, I guess I want to ask you a loaded question. You mentioned the GOP caucus, and I don't want to let the Democrats.
He's an MSNBC reporter.
I was also first director of the Nixon Center. So, but you know, you mentioned the caucus in a way, and I don't want to let the Dems off the hook either. But as you're trying to sort of seduce your colleagues into taking something, you know, as seriously as this, and look, I am, you know, loaded with data right now. You know, 96% of the cancer project proposals that have come up are declined because of cost. You had in the pediatric cancer, I think I learned this from Nancy, 4 drugs came out for kids in the same period that 200 came out for adults. And so when you look at some of these issues and disparities, you know, part of it is, I mean, I'm so grateful that you're doing what you're doing, but it kind of raises the question of why is the ecosystem about science, research, NIH, the broad notion that investment pays off, not something that is just globs on to the system so much more? Because the picture is not good. I mean, I just want to be clear. It's nice to have the success today, but the picture is bleak in terms of the decline in investment in these things.
Well, but the NIH funding...
You guys are in charge.
Well, we essentially doubled NIH funding in the last appropriations from last year, which was very significant.
Doubled?
Nearly, yeah, in NIH funding. And when I talk to the advocates, it's always, what about NCI, the National Cancer Institute?
Right.
Why are they only putting 4% of that funding into childhood cancer research? And so what we do in the STAR Act that's going to pass today is we put, you know, on the NCI board a pediatric oncologist, which was never heard of before. This will give the childhood cancer community a voice on the NCI board through a physician that specializes in pediatric oncology. So we think this will help improve that, what I think is unacceptable level of just 4% when you're talking about our children who have their whole lives in front of them, and yet we're only investing 4% in our kids. And I think that's that's gonna be something we're gonna continue to talk about. I also want to mention one other thing about the Creating Hope Act that is very exciting, was that Novartis used the priority review voucher to get what's called the CAR-T immune therapy program, basically approved by the FDA. Mm-hmm. This is very significant. This is personalized medicine. This is taking your own immune system and targeting the cancer cells directly. This is going to be, the future of how we treat cancer patients. Instead of using a World War I chemical agent known as chemo to attack the cancer and almost kill you before it kills the cancer, we will now have a way to personalize it and use your own immune system to attack your own cancer, I think, in a safer, more effective way. That, to me, makes a lot of sense. And that came out of the Priority Review Voucher program that the Creating Hope Act provided. Now, I will say that research has been, you know, since the 1980s, but it was great to see, again, that cause and effect between legislation and now a breakthrough in medical science.
Do you think we're making the right kinds of investments today, since you referred to the CAR-T, and the immunotherapy investments were made a while back, and I agree with you. I mean, that's where the revolution seems to be happening, and it happens to be happening in great research centers all across the country. Sean Parker has helped be a good philanthropist on some of this. But what do you think? I mean, you're proud of the 4 things you've gotten passed into law, or nearly passed into law. And so are you going on vacation, or what's next?
No, Never.
Yeah.
we always, I think every Congress want to work with the advocates on a bill that we can.
But what's next? I mean, what matters as you look at the quilt? Mm-hmm. What's the missing piece in the quilt that you think needs to be addressed?
I think getting increased funding from NCI is going to be something we're going to be really fired up about. I see that could be a big breakthrough, and I have to say the best lobbyists are not. It's these children that come up to Washington. You know, little Sadie Keller is a good example who I brought up, and you bring her into a member's office, and Republican, Democrat, it's very hard for them to say no to a bill that's going to help somebody like Sadie. Mm-hmm. I actually had to go on national television with her. If there is a signing ceremony, I'm going to bring her into the White House for this thing to draw more public awareness to this disease that kills more of our kids than any other than anything else in the world. And this is a global phenomenon as well. It's not just the United States, of America. So there's a lot of breakthroughs. You get into the science. I find extremely interesting when I talk to the St. Jude's or, Texas Children's in my state, or MD Anderson, my wife's on the board at MD Anderson, and how we're starting to personalize medicine with genome therapy, your genomic code, and being able to find diseases and be more proactive and then treat it in a more effective way. I think we will look back in decades at the way we had to treat cancers of all forms and think it was very barbaric. My father died under radiation. My best friend in high school died from leukemia, which was a death sentence back in the 60s. And the good news is it's not today. One form is, but the majority of them have about an 80 to 90% success rate.
The president is part of the policy equation here. President Trump, it just occurred, just thinking, this just came to mind right now. And we have a big industry at the Atlantic watching President Trump. But one of the things that seemed to animate him were the death of children in Syria, in the gas attacks. And he kept talking about the babies. Does that become a useful lever in terms of dealing with a president that I may believe to be a bit erratic on a lot of issues, but do you find a pathway in on this issue of children and cancer with the president because of his predisposition to worry about kids?
Yeah, and Ivanka Trump has made this and human trafficking sort of a signature issue, which is why I feel confident we'll have a bill signing ceremony. And this is one of those issues that I think where Nancy Goodman and I really dropped our party labels and try to work on a common cause and not make this a victory for Republicans or a victory for Democrats, but a victory for, children in the United States that are afflicted with this horrible disease. And I think that is what's missing in Washington a lot, there's such a divide and a partisan rhetoric all the time. I think this is one of those issues that is, if there is a good news story, and there are a lot of tragic cases of children dying to this day, and I see them and the parents, but this is one of those issues that galvanizes both sides of the aisle on a common cause.
Let me open up the floor to any questions, comments from that right here. Yes, sir.
Congressman McCaul, Jonathan Agin from the Max Cure Foundation. I lost my daughter to a tumor, DIPG, that has a 0% survival rate. As the STAR Act is set to pass today, there's also the Right to Trial bill coming on the floor today, is my understanding. And there's a lot of patient groups which are lined up against the Right to Try Act because of their fear of how it will impact our community as well as other rare disease populations.
Right.
Do you have any concerns in terms of the interplay between what may happen with the Right to Try law and the STAR Act, and whether or not the Right to Try laws on the federal level may weaken what we're trying to do with the STAR Act?
Yeah, and I do have some concerns. I think the version that we passed in the House previously was a better version that was passed out of Energy and Commerce. I think Senator Ron Johnson, this is his big signature issue, and he has gotten the administration behind it and my leadership. And unfortunately, I couldn't stop it from coming to the floor. I hope it doesn't impact STAR But yeah, I recognize the concern in the community. I'm just glad that we have Star on the floor to sort of counterbalance, you know, that amendment.
Right. Yeah, Lee.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Lee Satterfield, and I want to thank you and congratulate you and your colleagues for doing what you're doing with the STAR Act. I am a childhood cancer survivor. I diagnosed with osteosarcoma when I was 17. I'm turning 60 this year, but I wouldn't be but for a heart transplant that I received in October of 2015. About 2 years before I became chief judge of the court across the street, the Superior Court, I was diagnosed with chemotherapy-induced cardiomyopathy.
Wow.
And so over that period of time until 2015, I suffered a stroke, had to get a pump implanted as a bridge to transplant, and just had a heart transplant in 2015, and I'm doing very well now. So there are significant costs to not treating the underlying problem. And I know this as a judge of 25 years, you have to treat the underlying problems to repeat repeat offenders from going to jail, because prisons are expensive just like hospitals are. And so I'm very pleased that you're attacking the underlying problem and better treatment, and also developing surveillance centers, because it was 30 years later that I found out that my heart was damaged due to chemotherapy. So thank you very much.
It's that, and let me congratulate you on your, you look great, by the way. That's what a heart transplant will do. And that's to the point, I think people just, and I know everybody in this room gets it, but people think that once the cancer is taken care of, that the issue is over, and it's really not. You carry that for a lifetime. And one thing the STAR Act can help do is identify patterns and you know, basically threat information with the doctors as to what other diseases could come out of the chemo therapy, which is very damaging to the body. You know,
well, we had a cancer survivor, and I was on stage this morning with Marie Mergori, who was talking about her cancer treatment for lymphoma, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, led to later a thyroid cancer that came in, and now they don't treat children with that kind of radiation anymore. And so I do think, but there's another element here which I think your case represents, which is, you know, what is our ecosystem for sort of long-term care? It's one of the things that Marie was raising, and, you know, is it what it should be? Any quick thoughts, and then we'll take a final question here.
Yeah, I mean, this is the STAR Act is designed at long-term
survivorship,
and the more information that, you know, it's amazing that doctors don't share this in a repository and a data system. So it's my experience after 9/11 connecting the dots to my experience with the biggest threat to our children, and not connecting the dots on, you know, childhood cancer survivorship issues. This will really help be a great step forward, and I think you're a testament to that.
Thank you, Lee. Danielle.
Hi, Danielle Leach, St. Walter's Foundation, co-chair for the Alliance for Childhood Cancer. Can you talk a little bit about the impact of the advocates and the impact of their work in the last 3 years on getting STAR passed? I think having 700 advocates, I think you have some examples of what that impact was, and I think it's important for people to hear the collaboration between the Hill and the advocates on getting this done.
Well, over the last decade, I've seen it expand and become more effective in your advocacy. I don't want to use the word lobbying, your advocacy for an important, probably the most important cause for our children. You know, I had so many people on the floor come up to me saying, hey, I talked to Greg Walden about getting your STAR Act on the bill because, well, these advocates, boy, they're just in my office. I'm getting all these emails, and, you know, even Burgess, who's going to manage the bill on the floor, he's like, yeah, you know, they just, it works. I'm just telling you, it's effective. When they get calls and emails from the advocates on an issue like childhood cancer, they do not want to stop this or in any way be obstructionist. And when you come in the offices, particularly with a childhood cancer survivor, whether it be a child or somebody like yourself, that's a powerful voice. And I've only seen the movement get stronger, not weaker. And I really applaud you, Danielle, for everything you've done for the Alliance and your advocacy on the Hill. It's the best I've seen.
So what do you say, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, we show up at your office for the party? Yeah, you're hosting the party in your office on the Hill, right? Yeah, so at 5 o'clock, Mike McCaul's office, so the STAR Act passage party, right? So this will do. Thank you so much, and I'm going to use his words. It's real a pleasure to spend time with a hardcore, reasonable Republican. So thank you so much. Mike McCaul, thank you very much.